time and said I looked like something out of 1001 Dalmatians. I think it was 1001 Nights. Or maybe 120 days. Thank you for coming. The first thing I wanted to say, I've got a few films to show you that came from where I come from. And really the first thing to say actually is that this is the wrong slide. Actually the first slide should be this one. Welcome to the Parallel University's introductory course in on the subject of belief. I'm told that there are some students here today who are still labouring under the misapprehension that they exist on a single plane only. Particularly, some of your tutors have told me that a sizable number of the student population believe that they're attending some kind of experimental music festival, whereas obviously this is not the only case. And if you continue to hold this view steadfastly, you're going to have great difficulty in passing the course. So what I'd like to do today is to get you to question some of your beliefs about the various planes that we live on, planes of existence, planes of experience. This is a film that I shot at a festival. As you can see, it's quite scary. That's a bit too loud, I think, because I want to talk to you as well. This is a festival where people who have tattoos of a particular kind, tattoos not done in tattoo parlours, not done in back streets, not done in the normal kind of places where you'd expect tattoos to be done, but done by holy men, by religious persons. And the people in the film believe that the tattoos convey some kind of protection. Protection against the speeding bullet, the slicing machete, the vicious gangster. And who's to say whether they're right or not in their belief? On this, the day that this film is taken, happens once a year, and the guys that have these tattoos, I think it's actually pretty much exclusively guys who have them, come to have them recharged, just like a top-up. And they believe that when they all gather in this place and meditate and take part in the activities, that their tattoos will increase in power. And so they do. But what happens also is, as well as participating, as you can see, they become possessed. They become possessed by the spirits, you know, that empower the tattoos. This gathering of soldiers is the thing that I want you to question your beliefs, your prejudices, your ideas about. These soldiers are here not to quell a riot, not to crush the opposition. They're here to pick these boys up and rub their ears. Believe me or not, it's true. Let me see if this works. should they get possessed, the soldiers will catch them. And when they pick them up off the ground and rub their ears, they'll return to this plane. The possession will leave them. Although quite often the same people come around over and over again. Tattoos have power. Here's another question. In fact, I don't know if anybody's seen the catalogue, but there's a little piece I wrote in there about how I had this theory that street boys and bar girls and people that would normally be regarded as the dregs of society have a more immediate access to the deity. And I don't know if necessarily anyone here, you know, holds the view of the higher power and the deity and all that stuff, but I know that where I come from, the people do. You may remember a few years back there was a tsunami that killed about 4,000 people in Thailand alone and many, many more around the world. And on the day that that happened, I was in Bangkok and out at a bar. What a surprise on that night. But The atmosphere in the bars that night was a bit weird, and directly they all closed, all of the boys in the bar that I was at got dressed, and instead of just hanging around to get food and talk to their friends and stuff as normally happens, they all, as a body, the whole staff of this one street where all these gay boys are, went to the nearby temple. Because they, they wanted to pray and give money and offerings, and to pray for the souls of the people that have been drowned. And I had a kind of epiphany at that moment, seeing these boys and girls, you know, many in their teens or late teens, whatever, praying for the spirits of people that they never knew. So this next clip actually attempts to send them a bit of the merit that they deserve, in my view. Across the bottom there is it's actually the Pali language. It's a Buddhist prayer for loving kindness. Generally speaking, Westerners are not renowned for supplying the people who make them happy with loving kindness. Money, okay, money for sure helps. And I'm not going to get into a discussion right now about whether prostitution is a good thing or a bad thing. I know in Thailand that it's seen not as a thing that you get paid because you put up with the shame of it. It's a thing, especially with guys, that guys do to feel good, and the money is kind of a bonus. But that's neither here nor there. Really. These people, anybody who provides a service, if it's a 40-year-old guy who's, or 50-year-old guy or woman whose mum has Alzheimer's, doesn't recognize them when they go around. I'm sure many people here have either experienced this already or will do. Anybody that provides help and assistance to another human being deserves merit. And to me, it doesn't really make any difference if there's any money changes hands or not. maybe an unpopular view, it's not a PC view, I know that. And the very notion of sex tourism, you know, is one that gets the journalists very excited and wanting to discover and encapture unfortunate ex-pop stars. I don't count myself as one of those, by the way. So it's another example of somewhere where the belief, where my belief is now completely different from what it might have been 10 years ago. And I urge all of the students on this course to reconsider the attitudes that they might have received from Fox TV News or even from their parents or from the British National Party candidates they elected by mistake. I hope it was by mistake. Nothing, I mean, it's a cliche to say nothing is as it seems, but one of the wonderful things about not living in England for a few years is that you get a chance to re-examine how you feel about things and a chance to see afresh remarkable things that just are nothing like what we were told. This track, this clip, I should say, I'm supposed to be showing you films, is actually, you might not believe this, is another question for your belief, a belief for your question. It features Brian Eno. It features him in a program that he wrote for the iPod, or he and his pal. Which is very good for making background sounds for when you want to talk to people about what they believe. This could be a little louder. A bit more. Great. It's one of a whole gamut of new toys that musicians are getting. For a long time, people think that I thought, actually, why haven't there been any new synthesizers made? Because all the synths that are made now basically sound pretty much the same. It's just that developments come in a different box. And if you're a one-man band, you need string that goes down to the hi-hat, and it's cooler. Thank you. we should stress. Actually, is anyone that's in the building who's not 18? Because you should have your eyes closed. And everybody on the screen, actually everybody in all of the films you'll see tonight is over 18. And some of the content you might see in the next 20 minutes features adult topics. Viewer discretion advised. Thank you. the climax of which Trent asked me to make the heaviest movie ever made, so I did. And of course he never showed it. But he leaked it to a video shop in Ventura Boulevard or something. And consequently, lots of copies were made that got progressively worse quality. And as they got worse, they got more and more like a real snuff movie. And lots of people in America, kids and student-age people, showed it to their friends as it being a genuine snuff movie. And in my view, it hurt them. It hurt me to see things that I considered to be genuinely snuff movies. And I think that it's bad for us to witness traumatic events. And I think it's bad for people to make films like Saw, because they want the thrill of experiencing traumatic events without the danger. Thank you. And the reason in India that monks live amongst dead bodies, amongst the burning ghats, amongst the viscerality of death, is because it gives them a more genuine view of the world, or of mortality and all that kind of stuff, of which I know very little. I'm not going to play any of the broken movie because we haven't got time, and you can find it on YouTube anyway. But interestingly, what I did find once, which I'm not going to play it to you, but you see that? Yeah. One of the boys brought me this phone movie, and it was shot in the south of Thailand. I won't play it now because A, we're short of time, and B, I don't think I need to. You can see what the fuck's going on. This is real. And what I would actually hope that you would take from me talking to you about this today is the fact that the real thing isn't like the broken movie. The real thing is like buying sausages. The real thing is just humanity, it's just people, it's just life and death. And if the entertainment industry and TV and the things that we watch day in, day out, where, you know, what's the statistic? Two people get killed on American TV every 2 seconds, or I can't remember what it is. If they could ever show things the way they really look, kids wouldn't want to buy guns. Kids wouldn't want to bully, play happy, slapping, or whatever the fuck it is. So I'm not going to go any further into that, am I? But I've got two more things I want to do. One is to play you some footage from the princess, the queen, the king of Thailand's eldest has died. And this is part of her funeral. It's a song that I've called Be Happy. Thank you. taking stuff from my house and selling it on the market. And, you know, being Western, I was morally outraged for about 10 seconds. And when I talked to my friend X, who used to be a temple boy and is at least as reprobate and naughty as I am, but I think there's an interesting perspective on things. He said, what are you going to do about it? Get over it. Get over it is his favorite expression. And when I took a breath to think about it, I realized that the odd few things that had gone missing were very important. And if I'd made a fuss about it, I'd A, look like an idiot, and B, would have been worse off. Obviously, I bought a new panel for the studio. But as Westerners, we tend to put our consciousness not in the present, or not in the present space. There used to be a club in Bangkok called Deepa, which was a place where people did way too many drugs, myself included. And my friends who are here shouted at me as I was coming back to the show, wake up though, you're in Deepa, which is always a danger, you know, of anybody who's likes taking drugs. That someday you might find that the experience of the last few years or whatever actually has been not as real as you thought. And that speaks to the subject of the lecture really, which is, you know, is this reality the most important or the one that matters or even the first in the cycle of realities that we all exist in? Hey, that's my house. That's one of my house boys. His name's Few. This was, I was just filming this off the telly on the night of the funeral. But the dancing just seems so happy to me, and it seems to express the state of mind which I think that X was saying I should hold, which is acceptance of now, of the moment. It's probably nothing to do with that. These dancers are all, you know, wear the masks of animist and pre-Buddhist gods and deities and spirits and so on. And the dance is a highly complex classical, you know, cultural tradition. But for me, it just seems like people having a good time. And why not? Travel agents inhabit one of the circles of hell because what they do is they make you ache for the future, and it's not a real future because they have no idea what Hilton Hotel in Pakistan or Baghdad or wherever it is like. They have no clue, but they just want you to look at the pictures in their brochures. And they want you to think that sometime in the future, next year or in the summer or Christmas, your existence is going to be better than it is now. They're so fucking wrong. Your existence now is the only thing that matters. And the only thing you can do to improve it, apart from work diligence, save money, don't take too many drugs, don't have a car crash, blah blah. The only thing you can really do is to understand that feeling good now is the only thing that matters, and not feeling good from the point of view of having a big car or a Warhol on the wall. It's not a question of whether the glass is half empty or half full, it's a question of whether you have sufficient. That's a complicated concept, isn't it? Thanks. So, one more thing to do, which is kind of tough. So, questions out there? Ulan, Bator. It's 11:15 now. I'm going to be another 5 or 7 minutes before I go off. But in Ulan, Bator, it's 4:15 in the morning. I don't have to wake them up because, as you know, Buddhist monks gets up at 3 to chant. And when the sun comes up, Ulan, Bator being quite far north, I think the sun will certainly be coming up already. So they're already up, so I don't have to wake them. But I've arranged for a kid called Chatri to sing for you. If I can play as well, once together. So this is the last thing I'm going to do. If I can make it work, and if I can get the phone connection going. Lewis, which, as you know, is a kind of smart, rather spooky sort of town. and the, as they were leaving, getting off the coach, the woman tapped me on the shoulder and said something. I took off my earbuds because I didn't know what she said. And she said, "Don't worry, things are going to be okay." Thank you very much.